We are ANC.
Sinovac asks Philippine authorities to be given the go signal for the use of its COVID-19 vaccines on children. Independent International Commission Investigate PH presents its second report on alleged human rights abuses under the Duterte administration. We're going to talk to the group's high-level commissioner, Attorney Suzanne Adley, as well as get the reaction of Malacañang from presidential spokesperson Harry Roque. Short eruptions recorded once again in Taal Volcano. And in sports, the Phoenix Suns cruise to victory in Game 1 of the NBA Finals. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us, and for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, nice to have you with us today. We begin with this story, Chinese drug maker Sinovac seeking approval from Philippine regulators for the use of its COVID-19 vaccine on children 3 years old and above. At present, only Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine has been allowed by the Food and Drug Administration to be used on minors from 12 to 17 years old. Children, however, are still not included in the Philippine government's vaccine priority list.
Yun pong sa gitna, yun pong Sinovac, Mr. President, yeah, today, just this afternoon, they already applied for an amendment of their EUA to include children. And in this case, children from 3 to 17 years old. So this is another potential vaccine that can be used for the pediatric age group. That we are, our vaccine experts are now taking a look at the data and of course asking questions sa proponents and getting more information.
So far, only 2.8 million adult Filipinos have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19. That's still a long way from government's target of 58 million by the end of this year. Health Secretary Francisco Duque III calling for stricter border control to help the country fend off the new Lambda COVID-19 variant. The World Health Organization classifies the Lambda variant as a strain of interest. Experts warn it may be even more dangerous than the Delta variant. The Lambda strain was first detected in Peru and has spread to over 30 countries.
Kailangan talaga bantayan po natin dahil baka biglang maging variant of concern. So ano gagawin natin? Patuloy na paigtingin ang ating border control, okay? Para makasiguro hindi ito makalusot mula po sa ating mga ROFs or OFWs.
The Philippines recorded 4,114 new COVID-19 infections on Tuesday, the lowest single-day tally in 2 weeks. This takes the country's total number of cases to 1,445,000. The death toll rose by 104. Local governments told to align their ordinances for fully vaccinated individuals with that of the national governments. Interior and Local Government Assistant Secretary Odilon Pasaraba says this is essential to avoid confusion.
Ang scope ng IATF ay national. Kung ang IATF ay mayroong polisiya o resolusyon, inaasahan natin na ang lahat ng mga lokal na pamahalaan ay susunod sa resolusyon na ito. Ang atas natin sa ating mga lokal na pamahalaan, kung ang inyong protocol sa vaccination cards or interzonal travel ay hindi alinsunod sa itinakda ng IATF sa kanilang mga resolusyon, bisitahin muli o amendahan o palitan ang lokal na polisiya.
Some local government units expressed concern over the easing of travel protocols. The president of the Union of Local Authorities of the Philippines, Quirino Governor Dakila Cua, said they're not or they were not consulted by the new policies. Skua also said many local officials don't even know how to implement government's new directives.
Although yan po ay panukala ng IATF, ang mag-implement po at mag-operationalize po talaga ang mga LGU. May mga tanong mula sa aking mga kasamahan po na paano daw po mabiverify ang vaccination cards. Hindi naman po sophisticated ang card natin. Wala naman po kami alam na may security feature or validation process ito. Our system na pwede namin check kung tama ba talaga ito or peke. Those are things that we need to operationalize bago sana maging in effect itong mga direktiba.
A doctor from the Okta Research Group believes the National Capital Region may become resilient to the Delta COVID-19 variant in just a few months. But Dr. Nicanor Austriaco says that will depend on how fast government can fully vaccinate the population.
As of yesterday, the NCR has received 29% of single doses, and each LGU has vaccinated between 20% to 70% of their population one dose, which suggests that a month from now, or a month and a half from now, that will be fully vaccinated people.
Austriaco also warns against easing the restrictions for fully vaccinated individuals too soon.
One of the things we have to distinguish here is between what is called effective immunity, where I do not get sick, versus sterilizing immunity, which means I don't get sick and I cannot give it to you. That's what we're waiting for Sinovac and some of the other vaccines. We have that data now for Pfizer and Moderna, especially from the Israeli experience. And the UK experience with AstraZeneca. Those countries suggest that those vaccines prevent transmission as well, which is why they're able to remove masks.
In other news, political parties of three former Philippine presidents finalizing an alliance with presidential daughter and Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio's regional party, Hukbong ng Pagbabago. The parties includes Lakas CMD, the party of former presidents Gloria Arroyo and Fidel Ramos, and Puwersa ng Masang Pilipino, the party of former president Joseph Estrada.
This is a renewal of an alliance that we made during the last elections. Our party, the PMP, does not have any candidate for president and vice president. So according to the agreement, it is the HNP that will choose the standard bearer for the presidency and the vice presidency.
Also set to join HNP, the People's Reform Party of the late Senator Miriam Defensor Santiago, the National Unity Party is also looking to form an alliance with HNP. Sara Duterte is seen as one of the top possible presidential bets in next year's elections. Malacanang slams President Duterte's inclusion in a global watchdog's list of so-called press freedom predators. Reporters Without Borders named Duterte as one of the 37 heads of government who cracked down on press freedom. It said Duterte waged a total war against independent media through false charges of defamation and rescinding broadcast licenses, among others. ABS-CBN, which is the parent firm of this news channel, was denied its application for a fresh broadcast franchise in July 2020. The palace refutes the findings.
Kung titignan niyo po yung findings ng ICC prosecutor, lahat po ng kinukot niya at media na critical sa gobyerno. So that proves po that freedom of the press is alive and well in the Philippines. Wala po ni isang kasong libelong sinampa ang presidente. Wala pong kahit sinong mamamahayag na napakulong ang presidente.
An independent international commission releases its second report regarding alleged human rights violations under the Duterte administration. Investigate PH laid out more evidence of what it says is the persistent failure of the justice system in the Philippines And for more on their findings, we're now joined by attorney Suzanne Adley. She's a high-level commissioner, investigate PH. She now joins us from New York. Suzanne, welcome to the program, and thanks for staying up quite late to join us today.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
All right. I want to first touch on how this second report differs from the first one you came out with.
Sure. So first, I just want to say that I am one of many commissioners around the globe who are participating in Investigate PH. And the report that was released today is a second in a series of three reports. And the initial report was released in March of this year and was released on the heels of the June 2020 report by the Office of High Commissioner for Human Rights at the United Nations that was a welcome report on human rights abuses in the Philippines, but still needed to sort of be expanded, strengthened, and improved. And that initial report was looking at human rights violations and lack of effective domestic remedies to address those abuses, and particularly how laws like the Anti-Terrorism Act and institutions like the National Task Force, the NTF-LCAC, are being used structurally to facilitate human rights violations in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. Now, the second report also looks at the lack of effective domestic remedies within the human rights context, but it takes a much closer look at three areas of escalating state-driven political violence, and namely the war on the poor of the Philippines under the guise of drug operations, the war on dissent, meaning kind of the escalating violence against human rights defenders, legal workers, lawyers, and environmentalists, and many others. And it also looks on the war on the Moro people.
All right. Now, I want to first talk about the lack of action taken by government to address this culture of impunity. What were the findings in the second report? Because in the first, you said that there was a lack of effective remedies in addressing what was happening. What did the second report show you? Did they gain any headway, or was it more of the same?
It was more of the same. There's no indication of headway. In fact, those who contributed to the findings of the report have also shown us a pattern of officials of Philippines police, for example, routinely covering up circumstances of killings and anti-drug operations and intimidating families of those who've been killed and potential witnesses, and participating in this culture of impunity by kind of obstructing the ability for redress to take place. You know, what we've also seen is that, you know, thousands have been killed in these anti-drug operations, and it's something that even the ICC has made note of, saying that this potentially could be crimes against humanity. And the style in which the thousands have been killed in these kinds of drug operations, what we've seen and has been described in this report is sort of increasing use of similar raids or police type operations, military type operations against dissenters, right? Mm-hmm. Against political opponents of the government, against human rights defenders, you know, throughout the country.
And let's talk about that now, because in the beginning, when we first talked, it was all about the Duterte war on drugs. And now that there's a spillover of this situation onto the war against armed insurgency, coupled with red tagging, coupled with the passage of the anti-terror law, how did this aggravate the culture of impunity that persists?
Well, what we're seeing in this, I mean, you know, there has been violence against dissenters for a very long time, and I came to first really pay attention myself to human rights abuses in the Philippines a few years ago when I read a report on the targeting and killing of lawyers and legal workers in the Philippines. And now we're, as I said just a moment ago, we're seeing that increase now with the same tactics that are have been used in drug operations, which is raids resulting in killings, resulting in cover-ups, resulting in intimidation of anybody who tries to seek any justice and seek any redress. And I think that overall, we've seen an increase in what are extrajudicial assassinations and killings of political dissenters of many types, right? Trade unionists, indigenous leaders, and we've named many. And you know, extrajudicial killings by their nature are, you know, done are basically kind of tagging, harassing, sentencing people to, you know, to basically be killed or in other cases be criminalized without any kind of due process. It's sort of very, very hard for victims and their families to pursue justice. And particularly because, you know, these styles of killings, whether they be extrajudicial killings of poor people or extrajudicial killings of human rights dissenters, the style of this violence is within a culture of impunity, and they're trying to also create a culture of fear, which also makes it very, very difficult to seek justice.
Talking about that culture of fear, tell us about your findings in Mindanao, what is happening there, and also the role of the U.S. that plays, the role that the U.S. plays in sort of perpetuating the violence there. Go ahead, Suzanne.
Yeah, so, you know, what we've seen in Mindanao is military operations that have, you know, perpetuated violence against Moro communities, against civilians, and increased and entrenched the marginalization of Moro communities as well. I know that the sort of operations in Mindanao are labeled as a war on terror by Philippines government, and I'm not going to go into the merits of the motivations behind the you know, those operations. But what I will say is that what we've seen is that even if the government claims it has legitimate sort of targets in Mindanao, they're not making real any efforts to protect civilians, right? And civilians, and they're not acting in a way that is distinguishing civilians from those who they claim to be targeting, and civilians have.
How do you say that? What's the evidence that points to that?
Well, for example, I mean, I read in the report about a raid that took place, and I'm sorry, I forgot the name of the city because I'm not familiar with all the names.
It's all right. It's all right.
A raid that took place in 2020. Even after I think martial law was officially lifted, right? And the raid sort of was described as sort of going after militants, and 26 civilians were killed in that raid, and there was no reports of combatants kind of being sort of brought to justice in any way, right? And you know, and, you know, we're also sort of seeing, I also read about instances of, for example, farmers in the Mindanao region also being killed, and the justification for it also kind of like being thrown into this larger war on terror operations within the region.
Yeah, is the fear there that this culture of impunity sort of normalizes collateral damage?
Absolutely, and that manifests in many ways, right? Like how easily civilians, men, women, and children can be caught up in these operations without any regard for their lives. It creates fear. Right, the militarization of their lands, like, and you know, and we also know that that has created also widespread displacement of the Moro people, many of whom have not been able to return to their homes.
Right. We do know that there is that ICC request for a judicial authorization for a full-blown investigation into the Philippines. And into the Philippine situation. What do you think? How might this affect the future findings of your succeeding investigation? We do know that there is another one, a third part of these series that's going to come out. Will that have any effect? What do you think?
Well, what we're hoping is that the findings of the first and second and third report can have an effect on the efforts of institutions like the ICC to broaden and strengthen and be consistent and thorough in their sort of the investigation and pursuit of justice in the Philippines. And, you know, and what we're also hoping, and because you mentioned this earlier and I didn't get a chance to answer it, but you know what I'm also hoping and speaking as a US citizen is that these reports and these findings will also compel civil society organizations in the United States, other parts of the world, but particularly in the United States and in, among our political leaders to consider the aid that they're giving to the Philippines government at a time of such gross human rights violations.
All right. Just as a final question, we do know that here in the Philippines, we're just a few months away from the elections. But from the initial report to the second report, what do you think, Suzanne? Has the culture of impunity become so entrenched that a new leadership come 2022 won't be able to fix things?
Well, I think that a new leadership, and you know, I'm not as educated on who is sort of aspiring to become leaders in the Philippines. But I think it's not just about new leadership. I think that there has to be new leadership, but also kind of rebuilding of sort of democratic institutions and in structures, like the leaving of building up of civil society, of public institutions in which the people of the Philippines can also sort of participate in helping to sort of move away from this culture of fear and culture of impunity. But I think it is very, very entrenched, right? And there is a lot of kind of reform that has to happen. And perhaps there has to be also some dismantling as well of very harmful policies like the Anti-Terrorism Act.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. We appreciate you taking our call. Attorney Suzanne Adley, sure. High-level Commissioner of Investigate PH, joining us from New York. Thanks again, Suzanne. Take care. Keep safe.
You too. Bye.
And that was a quick look at the weather today. Now, from our interview with Investigate PH, we're going to get the reaction now of Malacañang on the latest findings of that independent commission. Joining us now on the program, Presidential Spokesperson Harry Roque. Secretary, good afternoon. Thanks for joining us today. Welcome to the program.
Good afternoon and good afternoon. Yeah, and hello to all your televiewers.
All right, so I just had Attorney Suzanne Adley on the program. Basically, they were saying that the culture of impunity is still in the Philippines. There is a lack of effective remedies, and that there is also this spillover now from the war on drugs to dissenters, and also the violence that is happening in Mindanao, further marginalizing the people there. What are your thoughts on this? Your reaction to their findings, Secretary Roque?
Number one, I don't know this group. It's the first time really I heard of them. I don't know who they are. I don't know what their methodologies are. I don't know what compels them to do what they do. But number two, I think the PNP chief today had a very a major pronouncement that the PNP does not countenance any illegal acts committed by the police. And for the first time, I believe he came up with statistics that 5,000 cops have been disciplined. I think that shows that the Philippine state has been in discharge of its obligation to protect and promote the right to life, because the duty of a state is not to guarantee that the right of life will not be violated. It is a guarantee that because the right to life is non-derogable, that it will investigate, prosecute, and punish the perpetrators thereof. And I believe that the 5,000 policemen that have been penalized for various misdeeds is proof that we are in discharge of our obligations under human rights law.
Okay. Secretary Roque, you're joining us from Samar, correct?
No, I'm still not in Samar. I'm now in still in Quezon City. Samar is tomorrow, apparently. Yes.
Oh, okay. What are you going to do in Samar?
Well, it's actually to visit a town which has issues as far as mining is concerned.
Hmm. And why is that of concern to you?
Well, I got a series of letters from the townspeople, and they invited me, so I said I will go and listen, because mining is very important as far as the president is concerned. If you remember, it was the president that ordered a halt to mining activities, to new mining activities, and he ordered a halt to open pit mining.
What are the concerns of the residents there?
Well, I'll find out tomorrow. There's an intense debate ongoing in that part of Samar between those who oppose mining and those who favor mining, which I thought really was an issue that should be listened to by the Office of the President.
Okay, by the way, Secretary Roque, have you checked Twitter this morning? It was on fire when you shared that you were on that same plane that crashed, and people were reacting to it. Basically, they're saying, why are you calling attention to yourself despite the tragedy? So let me ask you, what was the context of that statement?
Well, the context really is we took the same plane July 1 to deliver supplies to Iloilo. And it's really to stress the fact that the disaster is a disaster felt by the entire people, by the entire population, and more so by people from my office, because eight of us took that flight to bring the supplies to Iloilo City. We have verified that the crew that flew us is a different crew from that flew that plane on that particular day. So everyone is a bit shaken because of it. Of course, the crew that flew us are shaken because it could have been them. And of course, just the proximity, July 1 and July 4, it could have happened to any of us. Hmm. That's the context of it.
So it wasn't in any way calling attention to yourself despite the tragedy?
Not at all. Hmm. Well, that's Twitter. You know what Twitter is all about. So yeah. I've stopped reading Twitter.
How's the president dealing with the tragic loss of many of our soldiers?
You see, the president considers every soldier, every policeman as a close relative of his. You can imagine the grief that he felt when so many of his soldiers died in this manner. And it's something that's very difficult to accept because the plane is new. It's full of young soldiers ready to serve the Republic. And it just is very sad.
Hmm. And talking about sadness and talking about grief, it seems like there is no such thing when it comes to the seeming lost friendship between the president and Senator Manny Pacquiao. What's the status there? How disappointed is the president with the senator?
I think the president mentioned in one of his speeches that all this time, Senator Pacquiao had nothing but praises for him. And all of a sudden, because it's near election time, he now says that corruption is three times worse than it was. No? So the president's sentiment was, if he knew there was corruption and he knew very well that he would not have tolerated these instances of corruption, he should have told him earlier.
Hmm. And is there no turning back from this disappointment? Is it really just disappointment, or is it something else?
Well, the president said it, no? If you knew, if you had information about corruption, you should have informed, or he should have informed the president sooner, because he should have known that the president would not have tolerated it. No? Mm. So the context by which it was said and the timing clearly shows that it must just be politics.
Mm. All right. Now, talking about politics, how serious is the president when he said that he is going to run for VP next year?
Well, he said it. It came from his own mouth. So I think it's serious, no? That he is seriously thinking about running for vice president. And part of the reason is he has unfinished business.
The president has said so many things in the past. Is this going to be one of those when he said it was just a joke? He wasn't really, you know, serious about it? Or being the spokesperson, you're part of the inner circle, you would know he's really serious.
Well, I think he's seriously thinking about it. And I think he explained that he thought of it now seriously because of the unfair allegations being leveled against him at a time when he's about to leave office. No? So aside from the unfinished business, it's basically his
secretary. Okay, we seem to have lost our connection with Secretary Roque, but no worries. Oh, there you go.
Yes, I refuse to. You lost me for a while because someone was calling, but he refused to be at the receiving end of baseless charges, and that if need be, he will get the people's mandate again to continue what he has been doing, his crusade against crime, his crusade against drugs, and his crusade for peace and order.
Yeah, but those are two different things, Secretary Roque, unfinished business and protecting himself from these unfair allegations.
Well, I don't think he meant it to protect himself, no? I think what he wants to prove is that he has the people behind him and that no amount of demolition job can destroy him. So that's not protecting himself. It's actually resorting to a political answer, a solution to a political question.
And the party in which he's going to run for VP, is it going to be PDP Laban still, considering what's happening to the party right now?
I believe so, no? Because yesterday he had a meeting with PDP Laban, and I don't know if the meeting has actually been televised, but the high-ranking officials of PDP Laban reiterated their call for him to run for vice president, and he responded very clearly that he's seriously thinking about it and that his concern right now is he may not have a good working relationship with whoever the next president would be. And that's his only inhibition about running for the second highest post of the land.
I was able to speak with a vice president for the Visayas of PDP Laban, and this is what Lutgardo Barbo told me. He said the rift, the cracks within the party started to show when the president started acting unpresidentiable. Basically letting down a lot of the members within PDP Laban. These are longstanding members of the party. What does the president think about him being the cause and the story?
I don't know
what is happening in the party. Go ahead.
I don't know who that person is. I have not heard of his name. I have not seen him. So I don't know why I should even comment to whatever he has to say. I don't even know if he's really vice president for the Visayas, because I know there is Mike Dino, who is not only a presidential advisor for the Visayas, but I think is also Vice President of PDP Laban Fuerte Visayas. So I'm sorry, I can't comment on what he says. I don't know him, I haven't heard of him, and I don't know the context by which he said those things.
Does the president even recognize that there is a rift within the party and that there are cracks within the party?
Well, I think he acknowledged that there is an ongoing rift, and he said last night that he wants it solved in a legal manner.
In a legal manner?
Yes, let's support him.
Okay, what are the options right there for him?
Well, I think he knows that all political parties fall within the jurisdiction of the Commission on Elections, and intra-party political party disputes fall within the jurisdiction of the Commission.
Hmm. So the president is talking to this faction within the PDP Laban. You said it yourself, he is seriously considering running for VP next year with all the reasons that you mentioned. How much time is the president devoting on this?
Well, I don't think it's a lot of time right now, because we're still focused on the pandemic response, particularly on our ongoing vaccination campaign. So I would say that the priority is still COVID, but it's a fact that he has to face because the timelines are fast approaching. There will be filing of certificates of candidacy in October, whether or not there's COVID.
What does the official family think? What does the official family think about this? The cabinet members, all those closest to the president, does he have the full support of the cabinet with his plans to run for VP?
Yes, I think everyone in the cabinet supports the proposal that the president should run for vice president.
And is it because many of the cabinet members also want to gun for higher office?
I don't think so. In fact, we're not sure who's gunning for higher office, but many of the cabinet members are really technocrats, and many of them are professional soldiers who shy away from politics.
But you're not one to shy away from politics. In fact, you have been vocal in saying that you are going to run if the presidential daughter runs. Does that still hold?
It still holds, not because to me it's important who the official standard bearer would be. I'm now in a press conference being held in Mandaluyong by a PRP, which is my official party, and we have just formally asked Mayor Sara Duterte to seek the presidency.
Is it possible that the Mayor Sara will run for the presidency using another party, HNP, of course, with its alliances, and the president will run still with PDP Laban, meaning they're not going to be a tandem, but they'll run separately?
In politics, anything is possible and nothing is impossible.
And so what do you think about your plans when you talk about the possibility and impossibility of things? Are things any clearer for you now?
Not really, because until the certificates of candidacy are filed, we don't know who in reality will be running. And I think that's the question in everyone's minds. No? Before they can even make up their mind who they're going to support, they need to know first who's running.
But not everyone is you, Harry. And you've had a taste of running for public office, taste of Philippine politics as well. Why would you still want it, despite what has been brought up against you, despite, you know, running and then not deciding not to run? I mean, it's a messy, messy situation there. And you still want more of it?
Well, because I've learned that when you use democratic institutions such as Congress, you can bring about change. In the 1 year and a half that I was in Congress, I sponsored the major social legislation that were passed and enacted into law during the Duterte administration. There's the universal health care, which we're all benefiting from now, which I filed in the first day, first hour of Congress. There's the free irrigation for small farmers. There's the free Wi-Fi, and there's the free lunch, no? Nutritious lunch for school children who are malnourished. No? And of course, having been an activist all my life, assessing what is more effective in bringing about change, I realized that sometimes change can really happen if we use institutions, no, rather than shying away from institutions. And that's the reason why I contemplate continuing a career in politics, because I have 258 bills of national significance which I filed in the year and a half I was in Congress, and I've only enacted about 8 of them into law.
Okay, we're going to have to leave it at that. We're waiting for an update from the situation in Taal right now. Harry, thank you so much for joining us today. Appreciate you coming to the show. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Good afternoon. Thank you. All right, from there, gray smoke seen coming out of the main crater of the Taal volcano this morning as it continues to show signs of increased activity. Let's get an update from there now from Michael DeLiso. Go ahead, Mike. What's the situation there? What else can you tell us?
Carmina, at least 4 short phreatomagmatic eruptions were recorded on Taal volcano this morning, sending dark gray plume from the volcano's main crater. According to the Philippine Institute of Volcanology and Seismology, or FIVOX, the phreatomagmatic eruptions happened 5:18 a.m., 8:47 a.m., 9:15 a.m., and 9:26 a.m. that generally lasted not more than 10 minutes. Phreatomagmatic eruption happens when the magma mixes with water, according to FIVOX director Renato Solidum. Based on FIVOX 24-hour monitoring, 55 volcanic earthquakes with weak background tremor were recorded. FIVOX is maintaining alert level 3 over Taal as a strong eruption is still a possibility. Entry to the Taal volcano island and Taal lake remains prohibited. At least 27 evacuation centers are now accommodating 1,200 families, or that's equivalent to 4,400 individuals, according to Batangas provincial government. Meanwhile, around 1.719 million pesos of damage in crops and fisheries were recorded due to smog and low dissolved oxygen. And that's the latest from Batangas. Back to you, Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Mike. Take care. You keep safe. And from there, we're going to take a break now. Up ahead, the black box from the crashed C-130 plane headed for the United States. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC. Stay with us.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility.
And we are back. You're still with Dateline Philippines here on ANC. Here's another look at our headlines this noon. Sinovac asks Philippine authorities to be given the go signal for the use of its COVID-19 vaccines on children. Independent International Commission Investigate PH presents its second report on alleged human rights abuses under the Duterte administration. More eruptions recorded again in Taal volcano. And in sports, the Phoenix Suns cruise to victory in Game 1 of the NBA Finals. Back with more news, the Philippine military will send to the United States the black box recovered from the military plane that crashed in Batikul, Sulu. Armed Forces Chief of Staff General Cirilito Sobihana said U.S. experts will be the ones to uncover the contents of the flight data recorder and the voice cockpit recorder. Sobihana also denied the ill-fated C-130 was overloaded. Is already the fourth crash involving military air assets in the past 7 months alone.
Short of saying na i-review natin yung ating yung airworthiness ng ating air assets at yung mga sasakyan pang dagat as well as yung sasakyan pang lupa para hindi natin maranasan itong tulad nitong very unfortunate incident.
53 died in that tragedy, most of whom were young soldiers being deployed to Mindanao. Australia extends the COVID-19 lockdown in Sydney for another week. This as more cases of the highly infectious Delta variant have been detected in New South Wales. The stay-at-home order was scheduled to end Friday, but has now been extended until July 16. 27 new locally acquired cases were reported in the state on Wednesday, up from 18 the day before. The total number of infections in the latest outbreak there has reached 350. The Delta variant fueling a fourth COVID-19 wave in South Korea. The country recorded 1,200 new COVID-19 cases in just one day. This is the highest case count in South Korea since late December. It prompted South Korean Prime Minister Kim Bo-kyum to extend social distancing measures for the next few days. Officials will also be looking into whether they will toughen COVID-19 restrictions. Just around 30% of the country's 52 million population have received at least one vaccine dose. The UK easing guidelines for fully vaccinated citizens beginning August 16. Those who have been fully inoculated will no longer have to self-isolate after close contact with someone who tests positive for COVID-19. The same policy would also apply to children or anyone under the age of 18. Fully vaccinated individuals will only need to self-isolate if they also test positive for the virus.
If someone gets their dose, their second dose, just before or just after the 16th of August, they'll need to wait 2 weeks, after which their second jab can take effect and give them these new freedoms. So this will allow the vaccine time to build up the maximum possible protection, those 2 weeks.
Britain is also set to lift its face mask mandate and limits on social gatherings this month. 64% of its population have received two COVID-19 vaccine doses. Hong Kong police arrest 9 people for suspected terrorist activity, among them 6 high school students. More in this report.
A table of evidence was on display as Hong Kong police told a press conference they had arrested 9 people on suspicion of terrorist activities. They are the latest to be targeted under a sweeping national security law Beijing imposed on the financial hub last year. Among them were 6 high school students. The police say members of the group had deliberately recruited them.
They all have some planning at some stage to leave Hong Kong for good. So the group is particularly interested in this group and recruited them to join the port to do the sabotage before their departures.
Those arrested also included a university management level employee and a secondary school teacher. It comes as Hong Kong's leader Carrie Lam said on Tuesday, ideologies posed risks to national security, urging parents, teachers and religious leaders to observe the behaviour of teenagers and report those who break the law to the authorities. Officers also froze bank funds and seized an explosive chemical from a hostel room, police described as a laboratory for bomb-making equipment.
They wanted to produce a TATP and they used it to attack some of the public facilities in Hong Kong, including the Cross Harbour Tunnel, railways, courtrooms, and even they wanted to lay the bomb in the rubbish bin on the street with a view to maximize the damage caused to the society.
TATP has been used in attacks by extremists in Israel and London. Beijing imposed the security law on Hong Kong last year, punishing what it regards as subversion, secession, terrorism and collusion with foreign forces, with up to life in jail. Authorities have repeatedly said it has restored stability.
And here's the latest on the collapsed condominium building in Florida. The death toll there in that tragedy has risen to 36. Rescuers pulled 8 more bodies out of the rubble Tuesday. 109 are still missing in the ruins of the Champlain Towers South. Meanwhile, several hundred people gathered at Miami Beach for the first funeral held for victims of the collapse. Back here at home, the San Miguel Corporation will begin charging toll fees on the Skyway Stage 3 by July 12th. SMC President Ramon Ang says their revised toll matrix has been approved by the Toll Regulatory Board. He notes its prices are lower compared to the originally proposed fees. SMC will post the approved rates at Skyway Stage 3 toll plazas before it starts collecting the fees. The 18-kilometer Skyway Stage 3 project allows motorists to travel between the South Luzon Expressway and North Luzon Expressway seamlessly. It can reduce travel time from Alabang to Balintawak from 3 hours to just 30 minutes. In sports, the Phoenix Suns coasted to a 118-105 victory in Game 1 of their NBA Finals matchup with the Milwaukee Bucks. Suns veteran Chris Paul and young stars Devin Booker and DeAndre Ayton had scintillating performances in their Finals debut. Paul ran rings around Milwaukee's defense with 32 points and 9 assists, while Booker added 27 markers. Ayton, on the other hand, controlled the paint with 22 points and 19 rebounds. Giannis Antetokounmpo had 20 points for the Bucks after missing the previous 2 games with a knee injury. Game 2 of the finals is scheduled for Friday, still on the Suns' home floor. And that'll do it for today. Thanks for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcasts.
Play back this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC.